In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord and bless his name. Tell of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous works among all the peoples. For great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. He is to be feared above all gods. For all the gods of the peoples are worthless idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Splendor and majesty are before him. Strength and beauty are in his sanctuary. Ascribe to the Lord, O families of the peoples. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts. Worship the Lord in the splendor of holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth. Say among the nations, the Lord reigns. Yes, the world is established, shall never be moved. He will judge the peoples with equity. Let the heavens be glad. Let the earth rejoice. Let the sea roar and all that fills it. Let the fields exult and everything in it. Then shall all the trees of the forest sing for joy before the Lord. For he comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness and the peoples in his faithfulness. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. You may be seated.
The Old Testament reading for this afternoon is from Isaiah chapter 6, verses 1 to 8. Found on your pew Bible on page 678. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him stood the seraphim. Each had six wings. With two he covered his face, and with two he covered his feet. And with two he flew. And one called to another and said, Holy, 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 in the Lord of hosts, the whole earth is full of his glory. And the foundations of the threshold shook at the voice of him who called, and the house was filled with smoke. And I said, Woe is me, for I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Then one of the seraphim flew to me, and having in his hand a burning coal that he had taken with tongs from the altar, and he laid it on my mouth and said, Behold, this has touched your lips, your guilt is taken away, and your sin atoned for. And I heard the voice of the Lord saying, Whom shall I send, and who will go for us? Then I said, Here I am, send me. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle lesson is from 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 to 5, found in the Pew Bible on page 1183. I charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing and his kingdom, preach the word, be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort. With complete patience and teaching. For the time is coming when people will not endure the sound teaching, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to whom to suit their own passions, and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths. As for you, always be sober-minded, endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, fulfill your ministry. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
gospel for this special occasion is recorded by the Holy Spirit in the book of St. Matthew, the 9th chapter, reading at the 35th verse. Please rise. And Jesus went through all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom and healing every disease and every affliction. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Teach me your way, O Lord, that I may walk in your truth.
Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path.
Unite my heart to fear your name that I may walk in your truth. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path.
You may be seated. A couple comments about the next hymn. Our Lord told us the gospel should be taken out to all nations. It's a privilege today on this sermon hymn to hear this hymn sung in two languages, not only our own, but Pastor Vang's first language. Okay. And I believe verses 2 and 3 will be sung in Hmong. I probably won't participate. I will listen carefully, though, as all of you sing it. We join in the hymn, sermon hymn, "Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing." Again, verses 2 and 3 will be in the Hmong tongue.
Grace, peace, and mercy to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus. We have been called by the gospel to be in this place of worship, to be in God's house, to be one body and one family in his name. Amen. You know, Matthew 11, when John the Baptist was put into prison and his disciples went to Jesus and said, "Are you the one that is to come, or should we expect someone else?" And I know that when a church has a vacancy, you might have a vacancy pastor, you might have visiting pastors come and preach for you. But those pastors are temporary. They come and go as if you're in prison and you just have visitors coming to see you. And so Pastor Chu, I have one. Well, are you going by Pastor Chu or Pastor Lang or Pastor Vang? Which one is it? I've known this guy for a very long time. So he goes by three different names depending on who you're talking to. But I have one question for you, Pastor Chu. Are you the one that is to come, or should we expect someone else? Because this church has been looking for a pastor for a while, from what I've heard. And I'm so glad that you have taken the call. I'm so glad that in Isaiah reading, you said, "Lord, here I am, send me." So here you are back in the Twin Cities. We are back together again. We've gone through a lot of things together. You know, Chu and I, we have a lot of things in common. We're immigrants, we're refugees. Our parents fought in the Vietnam War. My father was a foot soldier. His father was a pilot. And when the U.S. pulled out of the Vietnam War in 73, our parents were still fighting. And the war wasn't officially over until 1975. And our parents crossed over the Mekong River from Laos to Thailand. And we were in the temporary refugee camp in a camp called Nha Phong. And you and I were born in the same camp, from what I know. And so we have a lot of things in common. And we were both came here to the U.S. A lot of the Hmong refugees came to the United States, to Canada, to Australia, to South America, to Europe, in different places. But you and I ended up here in this great country, in the U.S. And for a time, Chu grew up in California. And we never really knew each other, even though we lived in neighboring cities. I knew all of his cousins, his friends, he knew all of my friends, but somehow we never got to meet one another until 2001, when he moved to Detroit and he ended up coming back to California, and we met one another, and it seemed like we were just a perfect fit. It seemed like we've known each other for so long because we knew the same kind of people, same type of people, and of all the friends and families together, and that's where he came to court his lovely wife, Sadie, and they eventually got married. But once Chu and I got together, it was like we were like best friends. And I remember going to visit him, and this is way before we were both pastors. We were second career pastors. And this is way before we got, you know, became pastors. And he was working at a Nissan dealership. So every time I was in town, it was about an hour away, I would stop by and I would say, "Hey, let me test drive one of those cars. I might be a potential buyer." And so I would go by, and we would test drive some cars. And one day, I saw one of the cars. I said, "Is that one of the new Nissan sports car?" I said, "Let's take it for a test drive." I took it for a test drive. I came back, and I said, "Write up the paperwork. I'm taking this thing." And I said, "Whatever price you put, it's okay. I'm not going to negotiate with you, because I know you got to make a living, too." And so I had to call my loving wife that I purchased a car without her permission. And so I had to drive an hour back home to bring her, and I showed her the car. And then she asked me, she says, "Guess who's driving this new car home?" I don't know why she's asking me questions when she doesn't care what I say. Then after that, you know, we spent a lot of time together, and a lot of time in God's Word. And with the help of God and the late Reverend Kuse Ying, we planted a church in Peace Lutheran Church in Fresno, California. And from there, when we planted that church and grew, and eventually I felt the calling to go into the ministry, so I told Pastor Chu, I said, "I'm moving to Minnesota, and I'm going to study to be a pastor. You should come." And he says, "I'll think about it." And a year later, he gives me a call, and he says, "Guess what? I'm coming up there too." And I was so excited. It's like having one of your best friends come up and study with you in the ministry. And when we were studying at Concordia St. Paul, from there, because we're second career pastors, we're older guys, you know, we said, why don't we start a ministry up here? And we end up starting a ministry over at King of Kings in Roseville. Well, Al Brown was the pastor there. And from there, it just kind of grew. And he went off to seminary, and I ended up staying, studying long distance. But it's kind of crazy how God kind of puts us together in different places. But I thank God who has called us to be together as brothers and sisters. And only that, but faithful people like you. You know, immigrants and refugees like us who came to this country wouldn't have been able to do this without the support of loving, faithful Christians like you, like Shepherd the Grove here, like folks at Peace Lutheran, folks here at King of Kings, because you have given us a place to call home. You have welcomed us. You have called us your brother and your sisters. And so being born in the refugee camp in Thailand, knowing that we were immigrants, we had a lot of hurdles to get through. And I thought about that this week, and I said, we were born in the same camp in the same year. We could have been best friends for a long time. We didn't even know it. You know, a couple months ago, Chu and I, we were talking, and we ended up talking for like 3 hours. And when I hung up the phone, my wife says, you guys talked for 3 hours. What did you guys talk about? And I said, nothing. I mean, if you ask a guy what they've been talking about, we can give you like a 10-minute synopsis, right? If I was to ask my wife what she talked about in 10 minutes, she'll give me the hour version of that. But today is what I call a momentous day, momentous occasion. And I'll come back to that in a little bit. But I think Pastor Chu and I have a lot of things in common. We have the same Lord. All of us have the same thing in common. We have the same God. And God has called us to be his sons and his daughters. And we have heeded the call. We have come together as brothers and sisters from different nations, from different languages, together here to be as one in God's house, worshiping him, calling on our Lord, who is our Savior. And so this installation of Pastor Chu, you know, to some of you, it might just be another installation. But for us, who have gone through so much, who has been brought here into this great country, for us, this is a momentous occasion, because that means that we have been accepted. That means that we have been called together. That means that we are one. It means we are a child of God under one God. And so this is a positive reaction. This is a positive moment in the Minnesota South District. And you don't realize this, but what you have done is caused a chain reaction for mission in the South District for decades and years to come. And so I want you guys, Shepherd the Grove, to be proud of that. So I have one question for Shepherd the Grove, the folks here. Are you ready to go on to this adventure with your new pastor?
Yes.
Lutherans responding, right? Because I give you this little story about your new pastor to know that what kind of a pastor you are getting. He's a missional pastor. He's an evangelist. He will rebuke you, but he is a humble pastor. He is a loving pastor. He is patient, and he is kind. All the words that come from Corinthians, all the words that the Lord has said, this is the kind of Christian. This is the kind of person that you should be. And so I'm very proud to call you brother and friend. And so he will lead you with God's word. He will lead you to call the lost to be found. He'll lead you to call those who are in darkness into light. And many of us come to church for different reasons. We are in different parts in our life. It doesn't matter what culture you come from. We all live in some kind of suffering, some kind of darkness, some kind of pain. And we are called to be there when those who need it the most. Because there are things in life that we cannot fulfill. And we think that we can fix things on our own, but we cannot. It's like God calls us to be the workers. In our reading today, he says, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. And so Shepherd of the Grove, congregation. May you be those people. May you be the workers that call, that says, "Here I am, Lord, send me." In our epistle in Timothy, when Paul's telling the new pastor, he says, "Preach the word, be prepared in season and out of season, correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and careful instructions." And this is the man that you have called. So why do you call a pastor? You call him so that he can proclaim the good news of Jesus. You call so that he can proclaim the good news to bring you comfort, to bring you peace. But not only that, he's also called to those who are being afflicted to be comforted. But for those of you who are comfortable, the word of God will afflict you. Not in a bad way, in a way that will make you think that if we are comfortable, how can the word of God afflict our hearts to change us, to be this new creation that God has called us to be? And I know that you are ready for that. Now, the Bible, the book of God, the many books of God in the Bible, your pastor will go through that book and he will prepare a sermon. And I know him. He's very strategic in what he does. He's very methodical in the words that he says, so that you will have itchy ears to listen, that you will listen to that and you will think about it. And he will ask you questions to make you who those who are comfortable, afflicted, in a way that you will question yourself, what is God calling me to do? What is the gift that God has for me that I may use? Now, speaking of books, I heard a story of a man. You know, he went to the bookstore and he was looking for a certain book in the education section, and he was looking for it and he was looking for it and he couldn't find it. And so one of the lady workers, she came by and she said, "Sir, can I help you find a book?" And he said, "Yeah, I'm looking for this book. It says Man, Master of Woman." And she thought about it, she goes, "Oh, that book, it's at the section that says fiction." The book of the Bible that your pastor, too, will be giving to you, it's in the section that says God's love letter to his people. The scripture is God's love letter to you, his people. And remember in the days when you were young and in love and you were writing letters to your girlfriend and boyfriends, or these days maybe email, right? But, you know, back in our days, and we wrote letters, right? And when you got that letter, you couldn't wait to open it to see what she was writing to you. And so our scripture that God writes to us, that's God's love letter to us. And when we open that book, it's like, I can't wait to read it because it's God's love letter to me. It's God's love letter to you. And so God calls us. You know, our Lord Jesus Christ, before he went up back into heaven, before he went up into the clouds, he told his disciples, and he gave the great commission, didn't he? "Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And behold, commanding all that, teach them that all I have commanded you. And behold, I will be with you until the end of the ages." And I take that as Jesus' last word after his death, after his resurrection, after he's been taken up to be of God the Father, our God. I take that as if it's someone's last word to me. And you remember being at the bedside of your loved ones, or you remember having a last conversation with one of your friends. And when they've passed on, you remember this last conversation that you've had. And for us, that's the last conversation that Jesus gave to his disciples. And so we hold on to that. We hold on to the great commission. We hold on to the great mission of God. Because if that wasn't true, people like Pastor Chu and I wouldn't be here. We wouldn't be in this place. We wouldn't be called to be God's people. We wouldn't even be pastors in a culture that's not like ours. But yet, we've been accepted, because we're all made in the image of God. And I know that one of Pastor Chu's favorite Bible verse, where Jesus says, "Greater love has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for one's friends. I know he loves this verse because he talks about friends. He talks about God's love, and he talks about sacrifice. And the sacrifice, oftentimes, when we think about sacrifice, we think about our soldiers, right? They go to war, and they sacrifice their life and their family for our freedom. But for some of us, sometimes what is sacrifice? It's not necessarily your life. It may be sacrificing some of your time, maybe sacrificing some of your gifts. If God is calling you to go and help someone babysit while they're at the hospital, that's what you're called to do. God calls us to sacrifice in different ways. And so the mission of God is not just being a missionary, but it's using your gifts in your setting, wherever you're at, in your context, to expand the kingdom of God. Why do we do that? Because of God's love for us in Christ Jesus, who died on the cross to save us from our sins, to make us white as snow through his red blood. And we are called to be his disciples. And so I'll end it with this, Pastor Chu. I know that you're going to be a pastor in a church, and you know we've done Hmong ministries for a while, but you know I've been over at King's for over 10 years now, and there's going to be some things that your congregation, things that they say that you might not understand too well. Okay? You know, things like a bowl in a china shop, right? You know, when I first heard that, I'm like, what is a bowl doing in a china shop in the first place? Right? Explain that to me. And they said, well, you know, it's kind of like a clumsy person or someone that doesn't really care. They just knock everything over. Right? I'm like, okay, I get it. Or how about, they'll say things like, and that's between you, me, and the post. And I was like, if they saw two pastors talking to a post, they'll probably think we're crazy, right? Why are we two pastors talking to a post? But the good news is, I hope and I pray that the message of Jesus is not just between you and the post. That the message of your God is not just between you and the post. That you don't keep it a secret, you don't keep it between you. That you share the good news, and you share the gospel, and you share the mission of what God has done for you. Because maybe you might not be so literate in the Bible, you may not know all the things like theologians and professors, but I guarantee you, if you tell your story of how God has changed your life, how he has made you into a new creation, no one can tell your story better than you. Because nobody knows your story except for you. So all the things that I've kind of said, you know, about the boy in the china shop and those things, it's just kind of tongue-in-cheek. That's another one. You'll have to ask somebody what that means later on, okay? I've kind of used up my Lutheran time hours here. You know. And so I pray that we continue to love one another, that we have our faith, that we heed our calling. And when the Lord calls, may you, Shepherd of the Grove, says, here I am, send me. And your new pastor, I know he will lead you well. He will love you. He is humble and patient and he's kind. And he will tell you things that will make you think, and he will help you grow in your faith, and he will help heed the causes. Lord, here I am, send me. The labors are few, but we will fill in that gap, and we will be called to the mission of God. And so may we continue to grow together, and if it's okay with you, let's start another ministry now that you're back in town, okay? Amen? I pray that the grace of God be with you, that the power of the Holy Spirit lead you to say, here I am, Lord, send me. And the resurrection of our Lord in Christ Jesus give you peace and forgiveness and new life. Amen.
Merciful Savior, pray.
By the gathering of our offerings and gifts, followed by the ordination hymn, "'Tis Not That I Did Choose Thee." We join in the hymn of ordination.
Thank you. invite the congregation to be seated and the brother pastors to come forward and spread out along up here at this time. Pastor Chu, invite you to stand as well as we'll continue with the rite of installation. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Loved in the Lord, through the church's usual order, the Reverend Chu Vang has been called by the Lord of the Church to be pastor of Shepherd of the Grove, Maple Grove, Minnesota. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, by your Son, our Savior, you always given to your church on earth faithful shepherds to guide and feed your flock. Therefore, we pray, make all pastors diligent to preach your holy word and to administer your means of grace, and grant your people wisdom to follow in the way that leads to life eternal through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Hear what Holy Scripture says concerning the institution of the office of the Holy Ministry.
Matthew chapter 28.
Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age."
From the Gospel of St. John in the 20th chapter, "And Jesus said to them again, 'Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I also send you.' And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, 'Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. And if you retain the sins of any, they are retained.'"
Hear what Holy Scripture says concerning the responsibilities of the office of the Holy Ministry.
Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." He said to him, "Feed my lambs." He said to him a second time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." He said to him, "Tend my sheep." He said to him the third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was grieved because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep." John 21, 15 to 17.
From the Gospel according to St. Luke, Jesus said to them, "Thus it is written that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins should be preached in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem."
St. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.'"
Paul wrote to Timothy, "Do not neglect the gift you have, which was given you by prophecy, when the council of elders laid their hands on you. Practice these things, devote yourself to them, so that all may see your progress. Keep a close watch on yourself and on the teaching. Persist in this, for by so doing, you will save both yourself and your hearers.
This is how one should regard us, as servants of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. Moreover, it is required of stewards that they be found trustworthy. 1 Corinthians 4, 1-2.
Paul writes in his second letter to the Corinthian church, "Such is the confidence that we have through Christ toward God. Not that we are sufficient in ourselves to claim anything as coming from us, but our sufficiency is from God."
Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, chapter 5. "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God."
In Paul's second letter to Timothy, he writes, "I charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing in his kingdom, preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort with complete patience and teaching. For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions, and will turn away from listening to the truth and wandered off into myths. As for you, always be sober-minded, endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, fulfill your ministry."
And hear what Holy Scripture says concerning the strength and promise God gives to those in the office of the holy ministry.
Our Lord Jesus says, "You are the salt of the earth, but if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled under people's feet. You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works, give glory to your Father who is in heaven." Taken from Matthew chapter 5. Then Paul writes these words in his second letter to Corinth. "Let the one who boasts boast in the Lord, for it is not the one who commends himself who is approved, but the one whom the Lord commends."
And a text from 2 Timothy chapter 3. "Continue in the things which you have learned, and be assured of knowing from whom you have learned them, and that from childhood you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work."
Dear brother in Christ, the Lord grant that you receive and keep these words in your heart, so that you may be strengthened and encouraged in your labors.
God gathers his church by and around his holy gospel and thereby also grants it growth and increase according to his good pleasure. That this may be done, he has established the office of the holy ministry into which you have been called by the church and have been ordained and consecrated by prayer and the laying on of hands. It is fitting that you should again acknowledge the responsibilities of this holy office in which you are to serve as a pastor of this congregation. So in the presence of this assembly and before our Lord God, to whom you must give an account now and at the last day, I now ask you, do you acknowledge that the Lord has called you through his church into the ministry of word and sacrament?
I do.
Do you believe and confess the canonical books of the Old and New Testaments to be the inspired word of God and the only infallible rule of faith and practice?
Yes, I believe and confess the canonical scriptures to be the inspired word of God and the only infallible rule of faith and practice.
Do you believe and confess the three ecumenical creeds, namely the Apostles, the Nicene, and the Athanasian creeds, as faithful testimonies to the truth of the Holy Scriptures? And do you reject all the errors which they condemn?
Yes. I believe and confess the three ecumenical creeds because they are in accord with the Word of God. I also reject all the errors they condemn.
Do you confess the unaltered Augsburg Confession to be a true exposition of Holy Scripture and a correct exhibition of the doctrine of the Evangelical Lutheran Church? And do you confess the Apology of the Augsburg Confession, the small and large catechisms of Martin Luther, the small called articles, the treatise on the power and primacy of the Pope, and the Formula of Concord, as these are contained in the Book of Concord, to be in agreement with this one scriptural faith?
Yes, I make these confessions my own because they are in accord with the Word of God.
Do you promise that you will perform the duties of your office in accordance with these confessions, and that all your preaching and teaching and your administration of the sacraments will be in conformity with Holy Scripture and with these confessions?
Yes, I promise with the help of God.
Will you faithfully instruct both young and old in the chief articles of Christian doctrine? Will you forgive the sins of those who repent? And will you promise never to divulge the sins confessed to you? Will you minister faithfully to the sick and dying? And will you demonstrate to the church a constant and ready ministry centered in the gospel? Will you admonish and encourage the people to a lively confidence in Christ and in holy living?
Yes, I will with the help of God.
Finally, will you honor and adorn the office of the holy ministry with a holy life? Will you be diligent in the study of Holy Scripture and the confessions? And will you be constant in prayer for those under your pastoral care?
I will, the Lord helping me through the power and grace of his Holy Spirit.
I invite you to turn and face the congregation. Beloved in the Lord, Holy Scripture says, obey your leaders and submit to their authority. They keep watch over you as men who must give an account. Obey them so that their work will be a joy, not a burden, for that would be of no advantage to you. From Hebrews 13, verse 17. Now you have heard the solemn promise of him called to be your pastor. Will you receive him, show him that love, honor, and obedience in the Lord that you owe to the shepherd and teacher placed over you by your Lord Jesus Christ? And will you support him by your gifts and pray for him always, that in his labors he may retain a cheerful spirit and that his ministry among you may be abundantly blessed? If so, then answer, we will with the help of God.
We will with the help of God.
Will you honor and uphold your pastor as he serves Christ in all his God-pleasing responsibilities? Will you aid him as he cares for his family? Will you be diligent to put the best construction on everything, recognizing that love covers a multitude of sins? If so, then answer, we will with the help of God.
We will with the help of God.
The Almighty and most merciful God strengthen and assist you always. I invite you to turn back and face me. So I ask you, Are you ready and willing to assume this public trust and responsibility?
I am.
Chu Vang, I install you as pastor of Shepherd of the Grove, Maple Grove, Minnesota, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good, that you may do his will, working in you that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Merciful God and Father, you have graciously promised that through the preaching of the crucified Christ, those who believe in him will be saved. By your Holy Spirit, grant grace to Chu, whom you have given to be pastor of this congregation. Grant him readiness and steadfastness in this ministry, patience, understanding, and great zeal. Support and strengthen him in your service, that by your word your church may be built and increased through your Son, our great high priest, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Go, therefore, and be a shepherd of the good shepherd's flock. Preach the word of God. Administer the holy sacraments. Offer prayer for the faithful. Instruct, watch over, and guide the flock over which the Holy Spirit has placed you. And do it not for earthly gain, but with great joy. For you have been called not to lordship, but to serve his flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that will never fade away. The Almighty and most merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless and preserve you.
Amen.
Invite the brothers to return to their seat at this time, and Pastor Chu will lead us after the hymn.
Joining the next hymn, hymn 537, Beautiful Savior.
Thank you.
Please rise. Let us pray for the whole church of God in Christ Jesus, and for all people according to their needs. For the gift of the eternal gospel, that it may be so treasured among us, that its glories may never fade in our midst, or its living light be lost to us. Lord, in your mercy. For the laborers of the Lord's harvest, and all who spread the gospel to every nation, tribe, language, and people, that all who dwell on earth may come to know and live in the freedom of Jesus Christ. Lord, in your mercy. For the faith to use our freedom in Christ to serve our neighbor in our daily callings, that we might bear fruit keeping with our new lives as God's children to the glory of our Heavenly Father. Lord, in your mercy. For all churches where the teachings of men have obscured the good news of God's grace in Christ, that the Holy Spirit may mercifully renew them in the truth of God's righteousness. And for those whose hearts grieve for the departed loved ones, that they may be comforted with the truth that those whom the Son sets free remain in the Father's house forever. Lord, in your mercy. Grant these our petitions, O Father, for the sake of Jesus Christ, our only mediator, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Tavachi from Kong from Montane, Tavachi Lune, the Chanjan Jamala Shine, the Tavachi Buddha Kashila Tane. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and grant you his peace. Amen. You may be seated.